Good morning, everyone. A wonderful and blessed Sabbath to all of you. We are the Pathfinders, and we will be conducting the song service for this morning. May you all be blessed. Our first hymn is going to be number 422, Marching to Zion. Our next hymn is going to be number 462, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Savior, all the day long, perfect. perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture, helpless on my side, angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest, I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
And then we are going to sing number 633, When We All Get to Heaven.
Good morning, Silverleaf Church. And we are welcoming Bulelo to the front to do the welcome.
Good morning, church. I'd like to welcome everyone sitting in the church in front of me. I'd like to welcome, a special welcome to all the people watching online. Thank you for tuning in. Another special welcome to all the visitors. Thank you for choosing to spend your Sabbath day with us. I hope you enjoy the program that we've set for you and be blessed.
Amen. For our opening prayer, we welcome Mackenzie.
Happy Sabbath. Okay, let's pause for prayer. Our Lord from heaven, thank you for another beautiful Sabbath day. Thank you that we could come to your house of worship. Lord, please bless the program that will be presented, and Lord, please open our hearts and minds to receive the message. Thank you for all our wonderful blessings. Amen.
Amen. At this moment in time, we are going to ask the Pathfinders to come to the front to recite the pledge and the law and singing the Pathfinder song.
Attention. The Pathfinder pledge is:
by the grace of God, I'll be pure, kind, and true. I'll keep the Pathfinder law. I'll be a servant of God and a friend to man. The Pathfinder law is for me to keep the morning watch, do my honest part, care for my body, keep a level eye, be courteous and obedient, walk softly in the sanctuary, keep a song in my heart, go on God's errands.
Oh,
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. It's running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. 'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my of the goodness.
God indeed has been faithful this past week. And especially to our pathfinders who prepared themselves, they are nervous. So please be with us and with them. The theme of the talk today is emblem of faith. Pathfinders is a very important part of my life. And although people maybe think, wow, why did this woman join the Pathfinders? But all the years I've joined the Pathfinders with my three boys, I was blessed with three sons that the Lord gave me, and all the years I did pathfinding with them. And that is memories that nobody can take away from me, and I am so happy to have that memories. Two of them are now married, but one of them are still into Pathfinders, and my younger son, he is not so into it anymore, but mommy's still in. So this morning we just want to focus on the flag and the Pathfinder emblem, just to remind you again the meaning of that and the importance of wearing a uniform. It's not just to be beautiful or to look smart. There's a reason and there's a purpose for wearing this uniform. So our first explorer for 2023 is Q. We call her Q, and she will do the first part for us, having a look at the flag.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Let's have a look at the Pathfinder flag. The Pathfinder flag is divided through the center, both vertically and horizontally, making four equal parts. The background colors of royal blue and white both have a purpose and a meaning, and the emblem centered in the middle. Today, we are going to be talking about the purpose and meaning of the Pathfinder flag, and especially the Pathfinder emblem. The color white represents purity. We desire to have the purity and righteousness of God in our lives. As Matthew 5, verse 8 says, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." And Revelations 3, verse 5, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment." Thank you.
Blue represents loyalty. It is the purpose of the Pathfinder Club to help teach us to be loyal to our God in heaven, our parents, and our church. Loyalty is defined as the reflection of the character of our true master God. Daniel 1 verse 8 says, "And Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself."
The Pathfinder emblem. The three sides represent the completeness of the Trinity, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. When we look at the triangular shape, it represents our aid that the Pathfinder organization is called to, which is the spiritual, mental, and physical development of each Pathfinder. Then the inverted triangle inside talks about the contrast teaching of Jesus, which is contrast and different to the way it is taught by the world, which is sacrificing oneself for others' needs. When we look at the colors, red represents sacrifice, which is Christ's blood shed for us. John 3 verse 16 reminds us about this. Also, Romans 12 verse 1 says, "Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God." When we look at the color gold, it represents excellence, which talks about faith and love. Revelation 3 verse 18 talks about, it says, "I counsel thee to buy from me gold tried in the fire, so that thee mayest be rich."
The shield represents protection. In the scriptures, God is often called the shield of his people. of his people. Genesis 15 verse 1 says, "Fear not, I am thy shield." Ephesians 6 verse 16 says, "Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked." The sword represents the Bible. The sword is often used in warfare. A battle is always won by offense. We are fighting the battle against sin, and our weapon is the Word of God. Hebrews 10 verse 38 says, "The just shall live by faith." Hebrews 12 verse 24 says, Hebrews 4 verse 12 says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful, and is sharper than any two-edged sword." Ephesians 6 verse 17 says, "The sword of the Spirit is the word of God."
Thank you, Explorer class. We are living in uncertain times. Ephesians 6, verse 14 to 17, lists six pieces of the armor of God. Now, each piece of the armor of God is essential. And the Bible tells us how to put them on and use them effectively. Now, each badge, as I said, the flag, the uniform, represents something important in pathfinding. Pathfinders keep the faith. Our reward will be great. Amen. At this moment in time, we will wait on the mission story by Ethan.
Okay, our mission story this week is about a couple called Victor and Eunice who wanted to serve the Lord as missionaries in a country like Angola or Mozambique. But in 1974, a revolution in their homeland, Portugal, put an end to their dreams. When the laws changed in Portugal, the Adventist Church was able to open schools in Portugal. The couple was drawn to Ellen White's education, or advice on education, which says, "In all our churches, and wherever there's a company of believers, schools should be established so children can be trained to become missionaries." The congregation decided to open a church school, and Eunice accepted a teaching position just outside the city of Porto. It took a large amount of faith, as this was the first Adventist school in Portugal. Church members bought the land for the school, and class started in 1975. The school grew from strength to strength, and Victor and Eunice were both principals at different times. The Adventist school has turned out one union president, 14 pastors, and 4 literature evangelists. A street has even been named after the school. Education is a major way the SDA Church shares the good news of Jesus' soon coming in Portugal. Part of today's 13th Sabbath offering will go towards helping expand Advanced education by opening a primary school in Setúbal, Portugal. Collect the mission offering now.
Bookend, come around to you.
Dear Lord, Lord, thank you, Lord, for an amazing day, Lord, to bring glory and honor to your name, Lord. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you'll take this money, Lord, and multiply it, Lord, and let it be used in a way where it will profit you, Lord, and help others. I pray this in Jesus' name, amen.
We will welcome the Pathfinders again to the front for a special item in music.
My faith faith on fire.
We are going to close our program with a prayer, and we wait on Rory for our closing prayer.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. God, thank you that today we could come to church and we could praise you and sing about you. Thank you that we can all be here today to listen to the message that you have for us. Please help us to understand your message and help us to have a good Sabbath ahead of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks so much to the Pathfinders for doing such a wonderful job. Didn't they sound amazing? Amen. Amen. All right. We're going to be dividing for the Sabbath school classes. The children's classes will be in the arena. So the Cradle Roll and Kindergarten are not going in the back anymore. So Cradle Roll and Kindergarten are going into the back. In their normal classes in the back. Okay, Cradle Roll and Kindergarten are going to their normal classes. And all other classes will be in the arena for their lesson study. Thanks so much and enjoy your lesson study.
Thank you. where we don't need to worry about work, about school or house chores, and we can focus on your word, Lord. We can focus in the rest of your day, the blessing that you bring us in the Sabbath day. And as we review the lesson now, what we've been studying the last 3 months, we pray that you be with us. We are sinners. Without the presence of your Holy Spirit, we are blind, and we need you to come and open our eyes and hearts so we can receive your word and allow your word to change us, Lord. We invite you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Maybe let me just give you this to read. All right. Okay, please. All right, so the last 3 months we've been studying the three angels' message, right? So by this Sabbath, the 13th angels, right? And but before we just review shortly the three message angels, I wanted to say that we are living in a time that there is so much advance in communication. I remember when I came first to this country, 1998, and I wanted to communicate with my parents back in Argentina. It was quite a thing. You needed to have some money to make phone calls. It was quite expensive to phone my family. Yet today, communication is just there, you know, in your phone. You can send a message anywhere in the world through the apps and through technology, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Anybody really can communicate with anybody. Yet, in the middle of this advancement, people live so isolated lives. You know, I remember in those days, I used to make an effort to phone my parents once a week. It was expensive, but I used to spend those runs just to be in touch with them, with my siblings, to let them know I'm fine in South Africa, how they're doing. And these days, my parents pass away, and if I phone my siblings once a month, I'm lucky. Because now we are so absorbed in our little bubbles that, you know, we are only focusing on ourselves and you know, our devices and our lives and what we want to do, that it's a paradox, you know. In the age of advancement and communication, we are so isolated. And the same can be said about spirituality. You know, in an age of so much advancement, we have so many Bibles, versions. I mean, if you have your device here, you have how many Bible versions there in a little app? You have Bible commentaries, you have the Sabbath School. And yet, how many of us actually spend time studying the Word? You know, at some point I was selling Bibles, and I had in my house, in my garage, more than 500 Bibles. And yet sometimes we lack the time to study the Bible, and we live in such a spiritual darkness. Do you agree? And in this context of a spiritual darkness is that it's so important, the three angels' message. Because everybody seems to have access to the Word of God. It's available in so many languages. It's available in so many formats. Yet, most people live in a spiritual darkness. And this is exactly what it was prophesied. You know, what we are living now is not just by chance. It's a fulfillment of prophecy, you know? Matthew 24 says, and the gospel of the kingdom will be preached all over the world, and then the end will come. But then there is another verse. It says, because of the lawlessness, the love of many will grow cold. So there is two groups here. One that will be engaged in spreading the gospel all over the world, and then the end will come. And another group that, because of this spiritual darkness, this loneliness, the love will grow cold. The question this morning that I present to you Where are we in these two groups? Either way, you are fulfilling prophecy. Either way. If you are engaged spreading the gospel, you are fulfilling that prophecy. If you are feeling cold and letting the things of the world kill your faith, you are also fulfilling prophecy. But the big difference is that we can choose where in which group we want to be. That is a big difference. And the messages of the third angels play a big role. And I want to give you a chance, if we need to give a summary shortly, what is the message of the first angel? How would you say it in a few words? By now you should know it almost by heart. What is, if somebody comes and tells you, okay, I heard that you've been studying for 3 months, the three angels' message. I don't know much. Can you tell me what is, in a nutshell, the message of the first angel? What would you say? Worship God. Worship God, thank you. What else? Yes?
Fearing God and recognizing him as the creator.
Okay, worship God, fear God, and recognize him as the creator. What else? Because the time of his judgment has come. So the first angel's message is an invitation to focus our worship to God, because he is our maker. Psalm says he made us. We didn't make ourselves. We come from his hand, and we tend to forget. Yes, brother.
you cannot talk about the first angel's message without saying that the first angel carries the gospel to all humanity.
Thank you.
Nothing else makes sense unless you understand that the three angels' messages are proclaimed in the context of the cross and the man on the cross.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing that, because that's how it starts, isn't it? Then I saw an angel flying in the midst of heaven carrying the everlasting gospel. So thank you so much, Pastor, for bringing that context to it. Yes. Second message. We started saying it's in the context of the everlasting gospel, the plan of salvation, what God has done for humanity that humanity cannot do for himself. God is doing it. And remember, God is our creator. He is our judge and is coming to bring justice. Second message. Anybody? Yes.
The apostasy of the Christian churches falling away from the truth of God. Hence, the Lord tells us to say, beware of Babylon, which has fallen. Mm-hmm. So there is a contrast between light and darkness, even amongst the Christians. So that's the context.
Okay. Thank you for that. So Babylon. Babylon is key in the second angel's message. But what Babylon? What fallen is fallen, right? What else can you say about the second message?
It's false doctrine.
False doctrine.
False doctrine, the wine of Babylon.
The wine of Babylon. Okay. You know, we know that Revelations use heavily language of the Old Testament. You know, images, the sanctuary especially. A lot of the major prophets, Isaiah, and we studied throughout the quarter that the symbolism of a woman, a pure woman, is that people of God that is faithful to God, right? In a relationship. And when the woman is presented in a way that she's not pure, a harlot, which is compared to Babylon, you know, the contrast is constantly, there is a contrast between, you know, Zion and Jerusalem and then Babylon. That was, you know, the enemy that destroyed Jerusalem. Then the pure woman that represent the people that are loyal to God, and then the woman that is a harlot, unfaithful. That in the context of what we've been studying is a false system of worship, false teachings. And this has a lot to do with the spiritual darkness that we were talking about right at the beginning. It means that it might look It might look that this false system of worship is strong and nobody can overtake it, but the message is, has fallen. In the same way that the physical Babylon fell, even though at some point was that head of gold that nobody could conquer, it fell. The same, this spiritual deception, this false worship, system of worship will fall. Yes.
Marcus, I think we must be very clear that Babylon represents a system.
Yes.
Because it's a common belief that even among church members, that Babylon is also within each and every one of us. And I cannot agree with that. Because if you reason that Babylon is within you, because you maybe have not understood the light that God actually reveals, and you're not there yet to understand fully, then you might say, okay, but so I am fallen because I have the sins in your life. But that's not what God is meaning. God is meaning you're on your path, you're walking with God, and God is taking you step by step, revealing his word to you. But that does not mean that you're in Babylon.
Thank you. This is an important clarification. It is a false system of worship that disseminates globally deception. But at the same time, as Brother Emmanuel was pointing out, this Babylon had a wine that wants to force people to drink. In the same way that the first or the three angels' message is a global movement, because it's in the midst of heaven and it's proclaiming it to all tribe, languages, and nations. What verse 8 says here, another angel follows saying, 14:8, and another angel follows saying, Babylon is fallen, the great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Yes. Let's clarify, this is a false system of worship. And the wine means those adulterated teachings. So we might not be Babylon, but we might be accepting those false teachings. And the warning is, be careful. Anybody else? Yes, you're going to say something.
Well, what is important is also that we have to recognize that Babylon is a great influencer. So in a world today where we live in, where everything is being marketed by influences and example and getting buy-in because we see what other people do, this is the marketing tactic of Babylon. And it says that he made all the nations of the world drink of the wrath of the wine of fornication. So if we don't, we all form part of that all. So we have to, in the last days, be so careful about what we let influence us, because we will follow Babylon. And what we must also remember is that it's also a message of hope, that it says Babylon is fallen. So we are actually have hope that we don't have to follow Babylon, because it will fall.
Thank you. Yes?
Yes, Marcus, this is why it's a war. The great controversy we forget about is the fact that it's a war.
Yes.
And no soldier is just sitting back and accept circumstances as they are. They fight in that war. And God said, if it was possible, even the very elect would be deceived. He says, if it were possible. But why is it not possible? Because they study the word of God, and that is keeping them from deception through God's power. And that's a prayer that you should also pray in these days, that God would keep us from deception and open our minds and open our eyes, that we can understand what he says. Because what it means to be sealed with the seal of God is meant to be set in the truth so that you cannot be moved. And how do you get set in the truth if you don't study?
Thank you. I think the lesson this week points out clearly, sanctify them in your truth. Your word is truth. And then the lesson also points out saying, those that want to do the will of God will know if this comes from God or not. Right? But it is very important. I think we are used to the news now. There is a war in Ukraine and in Russia. Nothing to do with South Africa. We have our problems here, but that is not one of our problems. But the spiritual war, we are immersed in that one. You like it or not, we are in it. Our children, our treasures, we call them our little treasures, isn't it? There is a struggle. Who is going to control their minds? You like it. There's no neutral. You know, South Africa wanted to play. No, I'm neutral. You know, I'm not supporting Russia. I'm not supporting Ukraine. There's no neutrality in this great controversy. And the forces are intentional. You know, some of us, we are like a little boat in the current. We just go where the water takes us. Sadly, some of us are like that. You know, if God bless us, I praise the Lord. If we have a problem, we stop coming to church because the Lord is not with me. So we just move like a little boat. You know, if your wife tells you don't talk, like, it's just an example. It's just an example, Pastor, nothing, you know. No. Now I can't worship God because my wife is interfering with me. No. You know, the lesson and this quarter is telling us the life that we live needs to live with a purpose and with a direction. Otherwise, without you knowing it, you are taking side in this battle. And that is why the warning is coming to us. That is why it says, wait, wake up. You know, the Lord is coming. He is coming. You are ready or not, He is coming. And there is a work to be done before He's coming. And if you accept that calling, you will be involved in this last day work. Okay, it's not only for pastors or elders. This is a work for everybody. And then the third angel says, then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice. Just remember here, constantly loud voice. You know, the first angel in the midst of angel with a loud voice. And every time the angels are talking boldly, you know, it's not like, oh, they are whispering in a corner, nobody hears them. No. They are talking loud. Everybody can hear them. So this is, which is power, pour out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He who shall be tormented with the fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of the torment ascend forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. And some of us end there, but it doesn't end there. There is verse 12, which is quite important. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So, you know, especially in the context of the third message, where it seems that apostasy is so widespread, that is everywhere, and that it's going to bring deception to everybody. No, everybody is deceived. There is a remnant. There is a group that keeps the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. So even though apostasy and deception and this wine is being drank by all the nations, God will have a faithful group of people. That the Revelation 12 talks about the descendants of the woman. Remember, the dragon tried to kill the woman, the son, but then the son was taken to God, and now his wrath goes against the descendants. And when he's talking about the descendant, he's talking about people that want to follow Jesus, that want to follow his commandment, want to be obedient, that wants to do his work. So we just made a little summary. Now, we've been studying these messages for the last 3 months. Let me ask you this now. In which way these three messages has impacted your life? What change has brought in your life, in your way of thinking, in your lifestyle, in your habits? In which way? Or if it didn't, maybe we are missing the point, isn't it? If this is just a knowledge for head and intellectual value, maybe we are missing the point. But let's say that that is not our case, that brought some changes, or we want this message to bring some changes. What those changes would be? I want to hear from you in the context of this. Yes.
Marcus, if I can just take a biblical example. If we look at the life of Daniel, when he was on his way to Babylon, him and his friends, they made a cognitive decision to follow Jesus, not to go with the current customs of the country where they're going. And if they hadn't made that decision and adjusted their lives accordingly all through their lives, when the crisis came at the fiery furnace, at the lion's den, they would not have been able to stand.
Thank you. I think what he's pointing out is a key point. I think studying this three angels message and Revelations 12 to 17, 18, all of this, is to make a conscious decision to take a stand for Christ. Number one. Thank you so much for that. Because we are involved in this great controversy and this great deception. And if you don't make a purpose decision, you will be swept away. You know, we've seen flooding this last couple of weeks. If your foundations, if your building and your roof were not anchored, you know what happened in the last couple of weeks. What else? Yes, Pastor.
I came to the startling realization that my passion for mission should be upgraded, because the passage that we're looking at today actually says that the angel, the other angel that was seen, came with great authority, and its glory illuminated the entire earth. And verse 4 says, come out of her, my people. So I had to admit, and we spoke about this, we were sitting outside and chatting about it. I discovered that as an Adventist, I have to apologize to God and to everybody that I come across with whom I have not shared this message, because God refers to people who are in Babylon as his people. And for as long as I've read the book of Revelation, I've never seen God referring directly to the remnant as his people. They are his people. But he makes an explicit statement when he says to people who are in Babylon, my people, which means God's love for those who are lost has gone into overdrive long ago. That's why Jesus died on the cross. So for me, I need to have some upgrade of some sort to feel that way about people who don't believe what I believe.
Thank you. I think what he pointed out here is very important as well. You know, the seal for sharing the message of the second coming and the warning against the judgments are coming should be something that will be driving us more. You know, it should be passionate. You know, yes, Sister De. Thank you. We need to remember that what Pastor brought us at the beginning in the context of the everlasting gospel, you know? And the everlasting gospel, the plan of salvation, is based on the principle of love. And that set the tone for everything we do. God sent his son because he so loved the world. He purchased every human being walking on this planet is being purchased by the blood of the Lamb. But most people are being deceived by Satan. And that's why what he's pointing out, Christ pays his blood for every human being to be saved. We mustn't take it lightly now, whatever happens. We must be intentional in deciding to follow Christ. We must be intentional in inviting others to follow him. And you know, there was another hand here. Who was here? Pastor, yes. You wanted to comment something.
That we spend a quarter of the years studying the three angels' messages, because God raised this church to preach this message, and this message really is what gives identity to our church and the mission that we are to carry in the world. Without you know, coming back to what identifies this, you know, church. We would actually look at ourselves as other, you know, like other denominations, and we would lose the essence of our existence. So both the corporately and individually, we are challenged that this is the message we need to preach to the world.
Thank you. And I think this is important too. Yes. Yes, Sister.
I wanted to mention something Louis mentioned to us the last Sabbath.
if we can all read the history of the Waldenses and see how they worked. Incredible. But you know something, brother? They made one mistake. The Catholics came, I think if Louis remembers reading that, that we don't trust some people coming to talk to us about stuff and saying, oh, you're believing wrong. And they trusted them, and they showed them their hideout place. And they came later and slaughtered them and everything. So, but if you read the history of the Waldense story, it will make you see how we need to get to the people as soon as possible.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I think what Pastor and Sister was saying here, you know, our identity as a Seventh-day Adventist, you know, and what she was saying now, you know, the history, we can learn so much from it. We don't need to be repeating the mistakes of the past if we look at what people did in the past. And, you know, some of us are part-time Seventh-day Adventists. We are not full-time. You know, some of us, we are Seventh-day Adventists on Saturdays. The rest of the week at work, nobody knows we are believers. You know? At home, our kids don't know. They get surprised when they see us in front talking that like that. We don't talk like that in the week. You know? So we need to rediscover our own identity, who we are. It's in our name, friends. Seventh-day Adventists.
I think what we also need to do, be honest with ourselves. Does Christ have full control of our lives? If he doesn't, what has got full control of our lives? Get rid of whatever that other thing is so that Christ can take the main place in your life.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, Marcus, there's a lot of theories of how we should do this and how we should do that. But for me, the bottom line is you cannot give what you don't have.
Thank you. You know, I think this take this week presents us 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 1 to 6, which is, it says what it should be our reaction to all of this. Let's just read that quickly and see what it tells us. Louis, did I give you the mic?
Yes.
I think, okay. Do you mind reading 1 Thessalonians 5, chapter 5, verse 1 to 6? And this is one of the important things that the lesson this week is with the knowledge that we got, okay, with the study that we did for the last three months.
Right. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober.
Thank you. I think this is also a result of being studying for the last 3 weeks. We should be not asleep. We should be awake. We shouldn't be in darkness. We should be in light. And we should be kind of ready.
It's the same as the virgins, the 10 virgins. All were sleeping, but 5 were ready because of the relationship.
Thank you. And now, talking about being ready for the final day event, some people say the best way to be ready is to country living. Don't get me wrong. I support country living, and I think it's an excellent way to raise children, to be away from these worldly influences, character development. But is that the best way to be prepared for the end of time? Country living, raising your own crops, you know, being away from the city. Is that the best way to be prepared for what is coming? What are the best ways to be prepared for the storm that are coming, according to what we've been studying in the last 3 months? Yes.
I just want to say that the battle is of the mind. Whether you are in the country, you may be in the city, but the battle is for the mind. Nevertheless, country living is part of the preparation. I want to bring to light this. Brother Reino talked about Babylon, and then there is the remnant church. So Babylon has got its teachings, it's a system. The Church of God has its teachings. The Church of God is taught to say, don't be deceived, which means the members of the church may be in danger of losing the privilege that they have to be in the light. Meanwhile, Babylon is taught to say, come out, which means they have also a privilege of being saved by coming out of that system. Now, my question is, can someone come out of Babylon mentally only, or they need to come out of it even physically and joining the remnant church? And the second thing is, on the remnant part, can a person be deceived while they are there? They can remain in the remnant, but they are deceived. They think they are doing the right thing. This is the battle of the mind that you're talking about. So I need clarification on that. That does it mean that being in the church, in the remnant church, then I have a privilege, a passport to being in the kingdom of God? Or does it also mean being in Babylon, then I'm going to be lost? What does God mean when he says, come out of Babylon? Is it both physical, mentally, and in belief? Or I can, some people, his people, like what the pastor said, can be in Babylon and yet they are his people. Why should they come out if they are his people?
Thank you. Okay, I ask a question, brother answers with a question. Okay, let me just repeat for the online sake, and then I will give you the chance. Brother is saying, what does it mean to come out from Babylon? It's just come out intellectually? It's just saying, no, I don't believe in this thing? Or is there another implication physically or lifestyle that we need to come out? And at the same time, if you are in the remnant, if you are following God's commandment, not because of salvation, but because that is the way you honor God and acknowledge him as a creator, doesn't mean now that you are deception proof, that you will not be deceived, or could it be that you still are vulnerable? This is a question he made now, but we will answer it. I just want to give a chance to the brothers that are raising hands. Yes. You want to say something, Pastor?
The writer says, he says, God's final appeal to his people is to flee the errors of Babylon and walk in the light of eternal truth found in his word. The key to everything is the Bible. Mm. As long as people stick to the Bible and follow what it teaches, they will not be deceived in the final crisis, particularly regarding the Sabbath.
Thank you. I think we already said, and Ryan also already pointed out, that the best way to prepare for these storms that are going to hit us hard is to be grounded in the Word of God. You know, we like to outsource everything, you know? And sometimes we want the church to be doing the work that we should be doing. Listen, the church teaches the Sabbath school to our kids, but if our kids and our youth were to know the Bible and be founded in the ground, it needs to come from home. You know, it's nice to have the Sabbath school. If you didn't read this lesson, like many of us do in the week, we come and get the cramps on Sabbath. Eating the cramps is not going to take us further. You will need to be grounded and solid in the Word of God in order to give you that strength and that power that comes from the Word to endure what is already happening. You know, some of us, we don't know, it's already happening, and it will intensify. Yes, sister?
You can know the Bible inside out. Satan does, but you have to have God in your heart. You have to know God.
Thank you. And it's not about head knowledge or intellectual knowledge. It's about obedience. It's about surrender our own ways and say, Lord, you know best. I will follow your lead. Yes, Rhino, you also wanted to say something.
Yeah. Revelation chapter 14 says, here are the patience of the saints. Here that of them that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. That's God's people. It's not being in a denomination.
That's not God's people. It's being obedient to the word of God. So what is the seal of God? God says the seal of God is in your forehead and on your hand. In contrast to the mark of the beast, which could be either in your hand or in your forehead. God says it's both. So what you believe, your actions will speak according to, you will have actions according to that. And Revelation 8 tells us that we must have this, Revelation 14, that we must have this relationship with God. That we accept him as our ruler in our lives, and we have to adjust accordingly. You know, if you do not adjust your life according to the word of God, it has no meaning. It's just a head knowledge. You know, and that will be like, then you can go to any denomination. But God says there's people, some of his people in other churches that does not have the light. But as soon as they receive the light of understanding what the word of God says, they will say, but I can't stay here no more. I have to move out and join the people of God. You know? So it's very important, but you to have the knowledge of God. You have to study. But if it doesn't transform your heart, you're wasting your time.
Mm. Thank you. I think what we said at the beginning, you know, how did these messages impacted you the last 3 months? What life changes you have done in your life? How do you approach differently the way you treat your wife, your children, your work, the way you see church? If it didn't in any way, then something very important is missing. Yes, Emmanuel, you wanted to say something.
Trying to answer the question, how do you prepare yourself for this? I'm just reading a quotation from Great Controversy 432. All who have truly repented of sin and by faith claimed the blood of Christ as their atoning sacrifice have had pardon entered against their names in the books of heaven, as they have become partakers of the righteousness of Christ. And their characters are found to be in harmony with the law of God. Their sins will be blotted out, and they themselves will be accounted worthy of eternal life. So I need to repent of my sin, I'll call on the blood of Jesus, be partaker of Christ's righteousness, and let my character be in harmony with God's law.
Amen. That is actually the core message of the book, Step to Christ, mm-hmm. If you think about it. You know, if I think we all need to go to the basics, you know, even though we are long-term Adventists, yes, some of us have been 20, 30, 40 years, but we are still spiritual babies. Confess our sins, repent, being washed by the blood of Christ, being covered by his righteousness, and that brings fruits of obedience. When you hear the word, you move. You know, we've been hearing the word and we're just static. Then something is missing, very important is missing. Then if the word of God is not created an impact in your life, if the Holy Spirit is not taking you beyond a short conviction every Sabbath morning into action, then we need to ask, Lord, please have mercy on me. I need you. I need you to transform my heart. You know, we are so used to asking to forgive, and, you know, Lord, please forgive me. But the prayer that we need to add to that is, give me a new heart. Because if we don't have a new heart, we will keep sinning. You know, we are sleeping with the enemy here, some of us. You know, one foot on trying to be in Babylon, because I like this, and then the other foot in the remnant. It doesn't work, friends. The Bible says nobody can serve two masters. Because we love one and hate the other. And some of us, we've been playing around. And friends, the Lord is calling us. The time is so near, we don't realize. And we are not only about salvation, our personal salvation, but this is the salvation of people around us. Starting with our family, with our neighbors. Yes, brother.
I'd just like to share a passage from Reflecting Christ, page 82. And maybe just... it really touched me in terms of how we summarize the discussion at the moment. And it says, the soul-saving message, the third angel's message, is the message to be given to the world. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus are both important. immensely important and must be given with equal force and power. The first part of the message has been dwelt upon mostly, the last casually. The faith of Jesus is not comprehended. We must talk it, we must live it, we must pray it, and educate the people to bring this part of the message into their home life. Why are our lips so silent upon the subject of Christ's righteousness and his love for the world? Why do we not give to the people that which will revive and quicken them into a new life? The Apostle Paul is filled with transport and adoration as he declares, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory. The character of Christ is an infinitely perfect character. He must be lifted up. He must be brought prominently into view. He is the power, the might, the sanctification, the righteousness of all who believe in him. Manuscript 27, 1889. It's Christ.
Thank you. That is what we said right at the beginning. You know, talking about the three angels' message without talking about Christ and his ministry of salvation, crucified, and his intercession in the heavenly sanctuary, then it doesn't make sense. You know, because that is the reason why there is war. Because he came to destroy the power of darkness so his children could be in the kingdom. All right? So, but, you know, let's be honest, friends. If son-in-law and what the lesson is telling us, the economic boycott start to happen on Monday. You know, they say there will be economic financial boycott to force you to worship the beast. Even if you don't want to, we will force you to go into it. And how? This. You know, a lot of people in the world don't care about religion, but this is the God of most people in the world. Think about the nations, China, Russia, people, Europe, which is so secular. They are not going to be moved by worship in the sense of religion. They will be moved by this. And some of us are worshiping this, friends. If you work so hard and you don't have time for anything else, you're neglecting your own family and your ministry because of work and this. Even though you might be in the remnant, your heart is showing that we are somewhere else. So what I wanted to say is, if these things start to happen as we've been studying it on Monday, the financial boycott, the spiritual deceptions that we know, you know, the fallen Protestantism will embrace Spiritism. You know, remember that quote? Presenting like the apostate Protestantism, one hand embracing the Catholic Church because the sympathy is through Sunday, and the other one embracing Spiritism through the sympathies of the immortality of the soul. Now, if this Monday things start to happen, that we see that this is actually happening, what we've been studying, are we ready for it? Not only to withstand, that is a part of it, but the most important part is the delivering of the message. Friends, it's not about withstanding this. It's about delivering the message. That's the emphasis of the three angels' message. It doesn't say just, hold on there, hold on, keep up. No, 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 it's saying there is a message that needs to go out. Humanly speaking, are we ready? Somebody can say, you know what, technology is so, you know, we have Hope Channel. It's easily, we just post something, it will be there. We tweet, and let me tell you this. Technology is so easy to just switch it off. It's just a little thing, and there's no signal. So let's not rely on this thing, guys. My personal take on this is, if this needs to happen on Monday, I am not ready. And I want to give you the hand, Pastor. I just want to emphasize this. Even though I've been studying this for the last 3 months, I can say honestly, I'm not ready. That is why what Pastor said in chapter 18, that other angel followed, I came with power and authority, and then the glory of God. fill the air. We need that power in order to fulfill this mission. And it's not by ourselves. It's the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of God, the authority of God that needs to be with us. Yes, Pastor, you wanted to say something.
Far back as my high school, you know, in our pathfinding, we're talking about the time of trouble, you know, and preparing for the time of trouble. But really, how are we going to gain that victory, you know, on Monday, say, it is by daily victory. It is by daily preparation. If we cannot switch off the phone, we can't do that. How can we gain victory on Monday or whenever the mark of the beast will be, you know, put? So really, it is by our daily Christian living. We must gain victory every day. Because we may not be alive when the mark of the beast will be. And if we are waiting for that time, we have lost it already.
That's right. The great controversy is happening right now. It's not just the... And what you said is a daily preparation. Listen, if we don't have passion for the salvation of souls in the good times, do you think you will have it in the bad times? When you be threatened, if you are spreading the word of God to jail. In the good times, when we invite you, you know, personal ministry, let's do it. We don't do it. Forget about it. It's not going to happen. Friends, the bell ring. Ryan, your last comment, and then maybe you can close with a prayer, please.
I just want to say, you know, we mustn't look at this thing as a big problem that's lying ahead of us. You know, like Daniel, we have to make the decision. There's daily preparations, like Pastor said. It's absolutely right. But what about people that today give their life to God? You know, and they haven't reached, like a lot of people think we must reach perfection before you can actually go. And that is not actually biblical. You know, God says you must give your heart to Him, like the thief on the cross, you know. But his life stopped there. But because he was sincere and pure, God says, my grace is sufficient for you. And he will do the rest for us. You know? But if he doesn't make that decision, and you don't do whatever you can do with the power of God to live a pure and holy life, if you don't do that, when Monday comes, you will compromise.
Thank you for that. Please, you mind standing up and we have a prayer, yes.
Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this lesson. We thank you for your word, Lord. Lord, we also want to thank you that we have a little bit of time left in this probation, that we can prepare our hearts and our lives to welcome you in the clouds of heaven. Lord, we know that the time is short, much shorter than we think, Lord. It might only be a few years, might be longer, we don't know, Lord. But if we look at the signs of the times that's fulfilling, Lord, we cannot others than understand, Lord, that your coming is even at the door. Yes. And that we need, as a church, we need you more and more.
Amen.
And we ask for your Holy Spirit to be poured out upon the church, Lord, in our home.
Yes.
Also be with us during this day, Lord. I pray a special blessing on each and every one here, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, everybody. God bless you.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome. Come inside, everybody. We're going to start our worship. We would like to start with "This is my Father's world." And after the incredible program we had this morning, we really need to praise the Lord. Wasn't he incredible? They did so well. So join us now as we worship with "This is my Father's world."
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, peace and the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, which shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear him pass, he speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world, oh, let me never forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world, why should my heart be sad? The Lord is King, let the heavens ring, God reigns, let the earth be glad.
Amen. Why should my heart be sad? This is the God that we serve. Incredible. Hymn number 39, "Lord, in the Morning."
Lord, in the morning, come.
There we go. Okay. Good morning, everyone. So good to see you here. Welcome to Silverleaf today. We hope and trust that you will have a blessed and rich experience here with us this morning as we worship our Lord together. So we have quite a few announcements to get through. So just the usual reminder that the whole calendar can be found on the church website. So if at any point you find yourself not sure when what is happening, that would be the resource to refer to. So let's start with today on the 24th. That's today, 4 o'clock, we have branch Sabbath school. And then this evening, there is a games night at 6 o'clock here in the foyer. And the Pathfinders will be selling refreshments. So come with full wallets and empty stomachs. I'm sure they will appreciate that. And we can all have some fun together. Then our VBS is coming up soon, 3rd to 7th of July. And you can register your children online. And also next week, Sunday, on the 2nd of July at 9 a.m., there will be physical registration here in the church foyer if online is not your thing. So please do register your children and have them bring their friends. This is a wonderful outreach opportunity. And the treasurer whispered in my ear just now that our thermometer is actually leaning more towards 27,000, 28,000. So a big amen to that. But we obviously still have a little ways to go. So we would appreciate any contributions that you feel inspired to make towards this program. Then the 14th to the 15th of July, there will be a Country Living Seminar. There's some detail on the screen there. We can look forward to some seminars, some testimonies, and also some fellowship and sharing some meals together. So I'm sure that that's something you can put into your calendar and plan to attend. And then on the 5th of August, there's a Bible quiz on the book of Matthew. And we are inviting you to enter your teams. We're looking for teams of 7. And the requirement is that you have at least one person over the age of 60 and at least one person under the age of 13 in your teams. For more information, you can contact Priscilla. Okay, now that was all the fun things. So now I just have some housekeeping to do. First of all, we have a first reading of a transfer out of Silverleaf Church, Yolanda Matisi, and that's from Silverleaf Church to Ovongo SDA Church, KwaZulu-Natal. That's the first reading, so we'll vote on this next week. And then the second matter is, as you know, when Pastor Ezra and his family left, it left a vacancy for our first elder, head elder. And we have managed to nominate someone who also accepted, who's willing to fill this position. And this is Brother Leon Hendricks. So today is the first reading of that nomination for head elder, Brother Leon Hendricks. We will vote on that next week. Thank you so much. Over to the welcoming committee.
Morning, Sabbath. Happy Sabbath, Silverleaf Church. Sorry, just an impromptu announcement. For the mothers that need to breastfeed, or the dads that need to give bottles, or for any babies that need nappy changes and all of that, the mother's room is currently occupied. So if you make your way back to the children's classrooms, you can go and do it there. This is only a temporary situation. So all the way back to the classrooms, we can do everything there in privacy. So please do note where the classes are. If you do not, ask any of the parents with little children. They should know by now where those classes are. Thank you very much.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. So we have a couple of visitors with us. And when I call out your name, please just wave or stand, whichever one you feel comfortable doing. We've got the Varley family all the way from Strand today with us. You guys can wave. What does the church say? Amen. And we also have Miss Hadassah from Solaris Pass. Amen. There at the back, amen. It's just lovely to have you guys. I hope you feel blessed to be with us. Thank you so much.
We will now sing our introit. We ask you to stand with us as we sing, O Worship the Lord.
Father in heaven, we want to thank you for your goodness. Thank you for bringing us into your house of worship. And as we have gathered here to worship you, we want to pray that your spirit may fill this room and also fill our hearts. Speak to our hearts so that when we leave this place, it may be evident that we have been in your presence. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Morning, everyone. Our scripture reading comes from Psalm 46, one of my favorite psalms. I didn't say the favorite psalm, but one of the favorite ones. I'll read verses 1 to 3 at this point. And it says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains quake with swelling. And we are at such peace because God is our present help. May God bless us. Amen.
Maranatha Masala. The Lord is coming. We greet you all in the name of Jesus. We thank the Lord that we have assembled and gathered to worship him today. We trust that the Lord has been good and you have been blessed in one form or another. As we continue with our worship this morning, I invite you to rise as we sing, Great is thy faithfulness. In fact, in the morning, the Pathfinders reminded that it is because of the faithfulness of our God throughout our lives that we have been blessed. So shall we rise and sing that hymn?
Changes not thy compassion.
kneel and we pray. Our kind and loving Father, we want to say thank you this morning that we have gathered in your house and have come in your name. We want to say thank you for all the goodness that you have showered us with. We thank you, Father, for many blessings that your hand hath provided. Great indeed is your faithfulness. We are grateful to be alive. We are grateful that, Father, you have kept us, you have protected us. We are grateful, Father, for all the prayers that you have answered. And this morning we want to say thank you, Father, even for those who were sick, and today we see them in church and we say thank you for healing them. We thank you, Father, that when we call upon your name, you don't disappoint. And for that, we want to say thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. We also want to acknowledge that, Father, some of us may be going through challenges, and we want to present them to your care this morning. We pray that, Father, whatever it is, you know, and we ask you to please intervene and cause every wrong to be right. And we pray for intervention that only you, Father, can cause. We also want to pray for this service, this hour, where we look forward to hear you speak to us. We pray that, Father, our hearts can be opened, and that, Father, we will welcome, respond, and be receptive to your word. And we pray that, Father, what you have in store for us will be realized. We pray that, Father, you can help us to be sensitive to your leading and help us to follow you so that you may have your way. We pray for a special blessing upon your manservant this morning, Umfundisi Mshosh. As he stands, Father, as he speaks, may we hear you speaking to us. And we pray that, Father, when this meeting is concluded, we shall say, really, surely the Lord has spoken to us. Father, we pray that you be with the leadership of this church and all the members, Father, those who are here physically and those who are joining online. May we all be equally blessed and touched by your Spirit. We pray and ask all this in the name that is above all names, the name Jesus. Amen. At this time, we will invite all our children to come to the front as Sister Anna Stein tells a story to and for them.
Wow, just look at you. Good morning, boys and girls. It's so good to see you all here on this sunshine Sabbath morning. It's so lovely to see the sun, eh? Yeah. A couple of weeks, there was so much rain. And while I was thinking about what story will I tell your children, I was sitting in my lounge and looking out of the window, and it was pouring buckets of water. It was just raining and raining, and there was no sun for days. And it took my memory back, way back, many years ago. Not 10 years, not 20 years, not 30 years, not 40 years, but more than 50 years ago. I like true stories. I was a little girl then. Mollies, how old are you now? Mollies, that age. And The mothers, our mothers in those years, they didn't go out to work. They worked at home. So they would come together. She and two of her friends used to come together to bake cookies together because that was the days of do-it-yourself. Everybody did everything themselves. It wasn't like today, everything was instant. Or they couldn't afford it. It was much better just to make your own things. They would come together and bake cookies together, or they would knit together or crochet together. And you know what else they did together? They would perm each other's hair. You know what that is? It's a very smelly experience. Those years they want to set their, you know, it's so strange. Our people who's got straight hair want curly, beautiful hair. And the people who's got beautiful, curly hair want straight hair. We're never happy with what we've got, eh? So they would come together, the three friends of them, and they would perm each other's hair. They would take small little curlers and they will curl it. They will pack it on the head. It will look like a helmet. And then they would take a developer. It was so smelly, I can still smell it. And they will put it on top to set the curls, and the curls will stay for a couple of months on the head like that. Then they will wrap it in a plastic cap, like a shower cap, and then a towel around it, and they will sit there around the kitchen table drinking their tea and eating their cookies, and they will chat, 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 chat. And I will sit here at the kitchen table, do my homework, or play with my dinky toy cars, or color in, and I would listen to all these stories, and I would go, all the stories that comes out. And this was one of the stories. The one lady said, guess what? What? We're going to move. What? And the other one said, oh, we too. What? My mother said. And they look at her. No, we're not going anywhere. But where are you going to? No, we're going to move to a new development area down by the riverside. Oh. And the other lady said, yes, we're going to build a house for ourselves right on the rocky ridge there so that we can look over the Vaal River and into the Free State there on the other side. Oh, the other lady said, though there between the rocks and the dry place. Yes, but it's a lovely view. No, the other lady said, we're going to build a house right on the edge of the river. Our plot is going to go right to the edge and we're going to have a boathouse too. Oh. Yeah, but the other lady said, yeah, but my husband said, no, that is dangerous to build so close to the water. She said, no, man, no problem. We will build above the flood line. You know what a flood line is? You know, a few weeks ago, our rivers, when it was all the rain, the rivers couldn't channel the water fast enough to the sea. And then it overflows and the water was going up, 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 and it flooded some houses. Now, normally that line there is a flood line and people are not supposed to really build beneath it. So I said, no, we will build a house above the flood line. So they built the house. She had the most beautiful house, the most beautiful grass, lawns going right to the edge of the river. And they used to take us out on Sundays on the boat. And the uncle had a big tube, tractor tube, and he would fasten with a rope on the back of the motorboat, and we will go up and down the river, and we'll go bup, 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 and sometimes we'll be flying off, and he will turn around and pick us up. It was such great fun. And she had the most beautiful house, thick carpets, velvet curtains, furniture, everything that of the best was in that house. And you know what happened then? There was a warning that lots of rain is coming. And I said, the people on the lower side of the next to the river must rather prepare to evacuate their homes. Oh, and the lady said, no, man, we're high enough. It never reaches so high. We will be fine. And you know what happened? That night, the rain came down and the floods came up. The rain came down and the floods came up. You know what happened? In the middle of the night, when that lady was trying to get off her bed, she was knee high in water. And the water already flooded her house. This is a true story. Already flooded her house. You know, she couldn't even get out with her car because the grass that was lower down was already flooded. They could only grab a little dog, she and her husband and the children, and they had to crawl up, go over their fence, and go to the other lady's house, who was built on a rock high. And though it was raining and storming and the weather was going past this house too, the water would just go around it and it will flow back. And you know what was so sad? Eventually, all the lady could see was just the tip of a house. My mom's friend and my dad took us to show us, and I can still remember to this day, all you could see was just the tip of the house. And that beautiful house was flooded with the murky old muddy water of the river and all the muddy water that came from the top. And it was a terrible situation, you know, and this made me think of two stories in the Bible. Can you tell me? Yes, Jesus told a story about a wise man who built his house upon a rock. And then the storm came and the water came and it flooded the house, but the house was safe. And then what happened to the foolish man's house? He's built his house upon the sand. Flooded it. So, okay, what is this house that we built on the rock? The house is us. It's you. It's your life, your body, everything that God gave you. And the rock is Jesus Christ. Hey, and if we believe in Jesus, if he's our firm foundation, if we believe in him, if we build our life on him, if we trust him, if we pray to him, if we read our Bible, do our Sabbath school lessons, come to church, and do all the good things, and let Jesus change our heart, then he is our firm rock foundation in life. And when the storms come of life, when things go a bit wrong and not so well the way we like it, we will be able to stand because our trust is in Jesus. But if we build our house on the sand, if we don't believe in Jesus and we just let everything go its own way, and when the trouble comes, what happens? We fall apart. We've got nothing to stand on. Even the difficult times will be absolutely devastating for us. Then there was another story. Noah built the ark for how many years? 120 years? Right. And what else did he do while he was building the ark? He was preaching the message of what's going to happen. A big flood was going to come, hey? And did the people believe him?
No.
No. Oh, they mock him and they told him, oh, no, that's nonsense. And after 120 years, all of a sudden one day, the animals started to move into the ark. Now, that should have been another sign for them. Wow, what is going on here? And still, they didn't believe it. And then one day, an unseen hand closed the door of the ark. God himself closed that door. And you know, when the rain started, only then they started to get worried. And when the floods came up and started to wash them away, they knocked on Noah's, on the door of the ark and said, please, Noah, let us in. But he couldn't. It was too late. Because God closed that door, Noah couldn't open it. So right today, we see all the signs that Jesus is coming. Is at hand. So we must get our hearts ready. We know that Jesus is coming soon. So get your hearts ready, believe in Jesus, trust in him, make him your rock foundation. Okay, let's sing that song. The wise men built his house upon the rock. The wise men built his house upon the rock. The wise men built his house upon the rock. And the rain came tumbling down. The rain came down and the flood came up. The rain came down and the floods came up. The rain came down and the floods came up. And the house on the rock stood firm. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, I thank you for every boy and girl here, and I pray that they will make you their firm foundation for life. Please protect them, be with them all the days of their lives. And when Jesus comes, that every one of them will go to heaven. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. You can go and take up the little hands offerings now.
Shall we pray for the offering? Father, we want to thank you for the gifts that your children have shared and have given. We pray that, Father, this offering will be a blessing to the church and to the ministry. We pray that, Father, it will be used to further the work of preaching the gospel. And we pray that, Father, you will help us to administer it properly. We ask that you bless all those who are able to give. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
The song that I'm going to share with you today is nothing new. I'm sure you've heard it many times. It's one of those old favorites. I'm sure you've heard me sing it before. But you know, sometimes when you invite people to your home, you use those trusted, favorite recipes. So
that's what I'm doing today. I'm using one of those trusted favorite recipes. But more than that, and I hope you enjoy it, but more than that is the reason why I picked the song is because of the hope that it carries with it. It's the holy city. And, you know, it draws our thoughts and our minds towards that time when the night will be over and we will be able to spend eternity with our Lord and Savior. Last night I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang.
Or star.
But I want to introduce our preacher today. He is no stranger to our pulpit and to us as Silverleaf, but for the benefit of those who may not know him, his name is Pastor Dr. Mshoshi. He serves All Nations Campus Church as one of the elders. He serves the Helderberg College as lecturer and dean or head of the Faculty of Theology, married to one wife. Together they have three adult children, and we are blessed to have you with us, Mfundisi. Thank you for accepting the invitation, and we pray that the Lord will use you to minister his word. What does the church say?
Thank you, Elder Pani. Maybe if I can just add, actually I have four children. Because my firstborn son decided that we should get ourselves a South African child, married one of them. And so my three children, my daughter-in-law, she is really my daughter too. So thank you very much. Thank you for that wonderful welcome. And thank you, Madeline, for the music, such powerful music. And thank you for the children's story as well. Yes. Very, very powerful. I'm glad you talked about something that pertains to flooding. And that you also talked about Noah's flood, actually, because the passage that we are going to look at talks about a lot of water, hence the title, Peace in the Storm. We can be at peace in the storm. By the way, I also want to say thank you to the beautifully dressed Pathfinders. I hear that you had a beautiful program. I'm sorry I missed it. I just could not quite make it on time. But it's always wonderful to see young people dressed in that uniform. And there are also some who are young at heart. Let me just put it that way, young at heart who are dressed in that uniform. And we thank you for your ministry and for your support for the Pathfinders. It's always good to be in a church where there are many young people. And not just many young people, many active young people participating in different things. It might appear to be small, but it is wonderful. It is a blessing for you to participate. May God bless you. Our passage today comes from Psalm 46. And I would like to read the whole psalm. I read the first three verses, which kind of are the gist of what the psalm is about. But I want to read the whole psalm. It's only 11 verses, so don't be too worried. Psalm 46, beginning from verse 1, it says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. Then in verse 4, there's a slight difference in scenery, so to speak. It says in verse 4, there is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God. So there is still water, but this is peaceful water that is associated with the city of God or the throne of God. And it says, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High, God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come behold the works of God, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bows and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in fire. In verse 10, it's God himself who speaks. In verse 10, it's God himself who speaks. All along, somebody was describing what God was doing in the midst of the storm. In verse 10, God himself speaks. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted above the nations, and I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of God is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let's just pause for prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for this word that brings courage to us, sometimes in the midst of storms. We want to pray that you may be with us now as we talk about this word. May you speak through me, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to imagine with me for a short while that you live in a security complex, very safe security complex. There are security that guard the gate 24/7. There are electric fences, very good security system. Your house is in there. And your house is also well protected within that security fence, perhaps with alarm and other security features, strong gate. But one day, you are aroused from sleep in the middle of the night. There's a bit of commotion in the front yard. And as you pull your curtains to try and see what is taking place, you see that there are intruders who have come into your house, or rather into your yard. But not only are there intruders, but you also see the security people handcuffed and maybe even bound to the posts of your fence or your gate or whatever it is. That is, they are immobilized. And in your fear, you decide to call perhaps the security gate in case maybe there are still some people there who may come as reinforcement. And there is no answer indicating that even that place also cannot give you any help. And maybe you decide to call 10111, that's the police number. And after a while, a voice responds, and in the conversation it says, "We are also under siege." I can see some of you saying, "Pastor, you must not watch too many movies." I've not been watching any movies. I imagined this story, but based on what is taking place in Psalm 46. Because in Psalm 46, what we are told is that the strongholds, the very things that we trust, can no longer hold. This is the picture that we are given here. So, we are told in verse 2, for example, that the mountains are in the middle of the sea. Now, mountains are supposed to be a place of safety. And the children's story illustrated that very well. A mountain is much better than being in a flood. Mountains are supposed to be a place of safety, a place of stability, a place of certainty. In fact, we have, we used to talk of similes. I don't know whether people still talk of similes, but when we were in primary school, we were taught similes, where you say as good as, and then, or as such and such, and then you give the example. We have a simile that says, something is as old as the mountains. So you young people, if you know, that's a simile that I'm giving you. You know, if you want to look at me and you want to describe me, for example, and you see a very old person, you might be able to say, as old as the hills. Because hills are known to be enduring. Hills are also a place of orientation, so to speak. Now, nowadays, we don't use hills so much. We use GPS. See, when we need to go a certain place, we just punch it in, and sometimes we punch it in just to find the quickest route. But in olden days, sometimes people had to use mountains as reference points. Where if you are lost, for example, you can still see the Helderberg Mountain and say, that's the direction I should be going in. I'll find a way that leads me. Mountains were places of stability, places of certainty, and we can even say of orientation of some kind. But in verse 2 and verse 3 of Psalm 46, we are told about mountains that are now in the middle of the sea. That means they have lost everything. They have lost their properties. They are no longer that stable. They have been overcome by the ocean, so to speak. And in verse 3, we are told about the waters that are roaring, though the mountains shake with the swelling. So not only are the mountains in the ocean, but they are actually shaking. I want to remind you that the psalm is not necessarily just talking geography here. It's talking about human situations. That there are times when the mountains, our pillars of support, are shaken, and it's as if they've been thrown into the sea. The sea, by contrast, is a place where there is lack of stability. Another simile, as boisterous as the sea waves. We might even say as unstable as the sea waves. So the mountains have been thrown right into the sea. I want to remind you that in Bible times, the sea was not, you know, was not always a positive thing. Lots of water, floods, were something that would cause people to have, to be uncertain. They did not have the technology that we may have today, where perhaps with big ocean liners, then we can be able to manage the ocean. The sea was associated with the flood. And in fact, the one time in the Bible when literally mountains were tossed into the sea was the time of the flood, Noah's flood. So try to think about that kind of upheaval that is taking place, or that was taking place during the time of the flood. The psalmist here talks about such a situation, and he says, in that situation, even in that situation, which might be similar to what Noah experienced, the psalmist says, we will not be afraid, because God is our refuge. And I want you to remember that during that flood, Noah was in the ark. Noah and his family, and the animals too, they were in the ark. And God was present with them. And though it was stormy around them, they were protected. And so this psalm uses that kind of imagery to remind us that even when things are difficult, we don't need to be afraid, because there is a God who is present with us. In fact, in verse 1, he is called our refuge. That is our place of safety. It's not the mountains that are a place of safety. It is God who is our refuge. And he is, as the Bible says here, a very present help in time of need. God's presence is what gives us peace. Ellen White, in the book Prophets and Kings, at least in two places, cites Psalm 46. At least in two places, she mentions. The first time it is in the chapter that deals with the story of King Jehoshaphat. You remember King Jehoshaphat, a righteous king. He experienced many things in his reign, but one of the things that is mentioned, in fact, it was the end of his reign, and it's also mentioned in Prophets and Kings, it's mentioned, it's kind of towards the conclusion of the chapter. It is the time when the Moabites and the Ammonites and the other nations around there, they formed a big army, a multitude of people, and they were coming to attack him. In fact, you can read that story in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, which I encourage you to do. And the Bible shows us that King Jehoshaphat, together with his people, they were afraid. They had no means to deal with such a big challenge. In fact, it is similar to the analogy that I tried to share with you. It is a place when they had no security. There was no earthly security. So it was a difficult situation for them. And when Ellen White describes what happened and how King Jehoshaphat was reminded that the battle was not his, that he and his people had to stand still and wait for God. The Bible tells us that he acquired confidence. And in fact, as they marched into the battleground, they did not have any weapons, but they were singing. They were singing. And when they reached the place where the battle was supposed to be, the enemies were all lying strewn on the ground, scattered everywhere, dead bodies, because God had dealt with the situation. And as Ellen White closes that chapter on Jehoshaphat, she talks of the people singing the songs of David, and she quotes Psalm 46. The Lord is our refuge and a very present help in time of trouble, she mentions. The other time that she mentions this psalm in the same book is in the experience of King Hezekiah, another good king. By the way, there are some people who actually have believed that Psalm 46 could have been written in the time of Hezekiah, and I was leaning in that direction myself, except in reading this last week, in reading what Ellen White says, and when she cites Psalm 46 during the time of Jehoshaphat, I'm beginning to think it was probably in existence already. It doesn't need to have been written in the time of Hezekiah. And in fact, she seems to suggest that even though it doesn't have a title here, it doesn't mention David, she seems to suggest that this might be a psalm of David. So we can remember David, of course, who also had a troublesome or a troublous time in his life, difficult circumstances where sometimes he had to hide in the mountains, which did not always offer exactly the protection he needed because Saul would seek for him and come very close. But Hezekiah is mentioned. And when we look at the experience of Hezekiah, we see that, yes, he had many experiences in his life, but one that is mentioned also towards the end of his life is the time when King Sennacherib came to attack him. And you can be able to read this story in 2 Chronicles chapter 32, but you also find it in Isaiah chapter 36 and chapter 37. And what you see is the Assyrian king, King Sennacherib, who had conquered the other nations, all the other nations around Judah, was now coming for Hezekiah, for Judah. And I must remind you that at this time, the other nations around had all fallen to Assyria. In fact, even the 10 tribes of Israel that had apostatized had already been taken into exile. And so it is only Judah, and of course a few small, I mean a small proportion of the people from Benjamin that remained, that made up the nation of Judah. And now Sennacherib has come. And among his threats, he indicates there is no one to protect you, Hezekiah. In Isaiah chapter 36, verse 19 to 20, here are some of the words that he uttered as he was threatening to come to attack this nation that is the only one standing. It's the only one standing. The others have been taken into exile. All of them have been defeated. It's the only one standing. And so the message of the Assyrians was, where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim? And when have they delivered Samaria from my hand? So he's basically mentioning some of the nations that had fallen, and he's saying their gods could not protect them. And so I'm coming for you, Judah. Don't think that your God is going to protect you, because other gods have failed to protect their people. Where are the gods that can protect you? In verse 20, he says, who among all the gods of these lands have delivered their land from my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem from my hand? So in other words, what he's saying is, you trust God? You trust God? I'm able to defeat him. That's what he's basically saying. And so we find that King Hezekiah was in this tight situation, and there was no one to help him. I want to ask, do we sometimes find ourselves in similar situations? Where is the source of our strength when we see the mountains in the midst of the sea? But what we are told is that God assured Hezekiah that he was with him. And again, God said to him, be still. This is my battle. In short, he was saying, you won't need to do anything. And just as in the case with Jehoshaphat, by the time Hezekiah and his people were able to see the enemy were all lying scattered. They had been killed through God's doing. It is God himself who protected them. They did not need to fight, but God did everything for them. You know, God comes and he takes, he actually does everything for us. Sometimes we have the notion that, well, I must at least do something. Now, that's not to say we should never do anything. I think we should do what we can. But ultimately, it is God who does everything that we need. It's God who comes. And through his angel, he comes. And because of this, we can be at peace, even when there is a storm that is gathering. Now, the peace does not come from some techniques of fighting that we ourselves have learned, because we don't have enough techniques to be able to fight. The situations that confront us quite often are beyond our own strength. But what we need to do is to rely on the presence of God in our lives. It is God who comes in to meet us. I want to mention that in our lifetime, we have had quite a few storms that we experience, things that have shaken the way that we live and made things to change in such a way that things will never be the same again. 2001 was one of those years with the attack of the World Towers, something which happened and it changed the world completely. made people to become afraid. Now, I do know I'm mentioning, that tragedy that took place. It's not the only one, but it's just that it took place in the very center of a place that we think was very secure. There are many other such tragedies that take place also in other places that shake the world. And in those communities, things are never the same. But after 9/11, those of us who were aware of what was happening before 9/11, were old enough to know what was taking place, we know that 9/11 created a new normal in many ways, in how we travel, how we use airports, and many other things. 9/11 created a new normal. There are probably a number of other situations in our lifetime that have created new normals. 3 years ago, COVID came and shook the world. A new normal came about. We now had to use Google for teaching. We had to use Zoom for worshiping and for fellowship, live streaming, and things like that. And in many ways, that is a new normal. A year ago, there was, Russia attacked Ukraine. And what happened there, or what is happening there, affects us. Go to the shops, and you will see that what is taking place there affects us. And in many ways, we are not able to control many of these things. And I want to suggest that in a short time to come, something else that will create a new normal for us as Adventists is coming, where we will have to flee to the mountains. But I want to remind you that the mountains that we will flee to can easily be cast into the ocean. It is not the mountains that will give us security, but it is God Himself. He is our very present help in time of need. Notice it talks about presence. Presence. And that is actually alluded to in a number of places in this psalm here. Verse 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of need. And then we go down to verse 5, when it is talking about this city that is at peace when there is trouble all around them. It says here that God is in the midst of that city. And by the way, I want you also to take note that from verse 4, when the storm is described, it is not a literal storm. It is nations. It is nations. But God is in the midst of the holy city, and therefore there is peace in that storm. And we go on to verse 7. Verse 7 says, the Lord of hosts is with us, his presence. And we go on again to verse 11. It says, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. We are reminded a number of times. In fact, 3 times we are reminded that God is our refuge. And he is present. He is present. I was tempted to say that when we find ourselves in trouble, we should seek his presence. But actually, that would be inaccurate. Because God's presence seeks us. Go back to the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve fell into sin the first time. And they were experiencing all the difficulties. They themselves were feeling the shame of sin. Their mountain tossed into the sea, so to speak. They did not go looking for God. They should have, but they did not. God came looking for them. God's presence came to them. He came to them. Hence we find that when Jesus came to walk on planet Earth, his name was Emmanuel, God with us. He is with us. And so his disciples did not need to be afraid. Many times they were afraid, but they did not need to be afraid. Because when they were on a boat in a lake, a troubled sea, and Jesus was in their midst, asleep, they were afraid, but they did not need to be afraid because his presence was enough. And with a voice, he was able to say, "Peace, be still." And it was okay. Another time when they were on the boat by themselves, and again a storm arose, Jesus, God with us, came to them, and he told them, "It is I." And so, my friends, we go through many different kinds of storms. I do not know the storms that you face. There are some storms that are common to all of us. The economics, financial situation might be difficult, but of course we experience it differently depending on our own situation. But that can be a storm that each of us may be facing. Health challenges. Sometimes as you grow, the body doesn't want to do what it used to do before. And you begin to experience that it causes you a little bit of uncertainty and you are scared about that. But God is with us in those kinds of situations. Bereavements. Sometimes through bereavements, our mountains are thrown into the ocean. And this very week that we have come from, the Cape Conference has lost one of the leaders, one of the pastors, passed away. I believe one of the district pastors. And it shakes us, and I'm thinking of the family. What are they going through? Lost a father, lost a breadwinner, lost their support. And in those kinds of times, we need to be reminded that God is present with us. And somehow he will help us to have peace. There are times when the mountains that are thrown into the sea are our very own families, family relationships. And we begin to see uncertainty in the way that the family is going, or the relationship is going, the marriage is going. And you see as if the mountains, that which you relied on, that which you had confidence in, it appears that it has been thrown into the sea. When such happens, enter into his presence. He is already present with us. He is close to us. What are the challenges that you are experiencing? Commit them to him. And as you face those challenges, I want to challenge you that you pay attention. Pay close attention. And you will hear him saying, "Be still and know that I am God. I'll be exalted among the nations. And if you let me, I'll be exalted in your life." May God bless you.
Amen, beloved. We thank the Lord for the word and for this message. Thank him for this. We are encouraged to trust God in the midst of storms and to be at peace knowing that we are not on our own. So thank you so much for sharing the word, and we pray that the Lord will continue to bless your ministry and continue to use you. To conclude our service, we will all rise and sing 528. a shelter in the time of storm. Shall we stand?
God, in you we find a safe retreat. Help us, Lord, that in our times of difficulty we may remember to enter into your presence. Thank you for being that ever-present help. It is possible that there is someone here whose mountains have been cast into the sea and they are troubled. Lord, I pray that your faithfulness may be demonstrated in that life. Give them calmness as they deal with the storms. Be with each one of us, Lord, and help us that even as we anticipate the storm of the time of trouble, that we may not live in anxiety and fear, because we know that you have made provision for us. And in you we find that safe retreat. And now, as we will be departing from this house, we pray that we may continue in your presence, that we may continue to receive your blessings. Guide each one of us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen.
God!
You may be seated. We will now sing hymn 330 as we lead out.
Another prayer?